SIG, APAC region. I am the senior developer relations manager. So today, very honored to share with you about Bluetooth Mesh and Zephyr.
I'm myself based in Shanghai.
And for this time, I am very happy to join you here in this session to share with you about Bluetooth Mesh. So it has been evolved from point to point, point to multipoint, and to today, multipoint to multipoint. So lots of evolutions to share with you today. Before starting today's session, brief introduction to our Bluetooth Alliance. It's Bluetooth Special Interesting Group, Bluetooth SIG. We're headquartered in Seattle, US. Now in APAC region, we're responsible for the technologies and the business development. I myself mainly responsible for technology development. So we have three basic tasks. The first task is specification. Now we have over 15 task groups. They are our membership companies, and they can join different SIGs. Work groups, task groups, to make contributions to the standards. The second, also very important task, is our qualification. Because within our system and framework, if you use our Bluetooth logo, you need to be qualified. And for our SIG, we have lots of verification policies to make sure connectivity can be guaranteed. And third part is promotion. And today I'm here, so this is also kind of promotion. And we will participate in exhibitions and trade shows, also trainings for the developers to promote this technology so that more general public will get the knowledge of the evolution of Bluetooth technology.
This
slide is about the timeline and a milestone of Bluetooth technology. So we established in 1998, and 20 years have passed. Within these two decades, Bluetooth technology came across two very important time duration. The first one, as you can see on the slide, the bottom part. We have our radio part. When we just published it, the Bluetooth is SBR, EDR, and also low energy. So after publishing of a Bluetooth 1.0, the main applications are point-to-point, and the scenarios are audio streaming for transmitting audios. You can think of the Bluetooth headset and also the speakers. So all these applications are based on the audio streaming scenario of the application. And for Bluetooth BR EDR radio, after publishing till now, it works as a long evolution application, also lots of smart speakers. In the overseas market, they have Echo from Amazon, Google Home, also Home Part. In China, we have Tmall Genie and Baidu and Xiaomi smart devices. They can go through Wi-Fi to connect, but also you can use Bluetooth as a very important channel for audio streaming on your phone. Bluetooth technology does not live on this milestone, the BREDR. Rather, in 2010, this is a very important bridge for us. And starting from 2010, together with lots of members, we joined a new the Bluetooth low energy, which is BLE. So with the participation of BLE, lots of app scenarios would be extended. So for the Bluetooth low energy, the most typical one is point-to-point application. After we joined BLE, we added BLE in our core specs in 2010. Afterwards, lots of smartphone manufacturers also included the BLE in their smartphones, also on their operation platforms for the designated API. They also support the BLE. So the first wave of BLE application explosion focused on the point-to-point. For example, sports fitness devices, health and wellness devices, and also peripherals and accessories. They are very typical, very simple scenarios. You can download app on your phone. You can have a wearable device and use the Bluetooth technology on your phone. It can communicate and sync the data with your phone. Another application is location services. From 2013-2014, Apple launched iBeacon and Google ID Stone. So for beacon applications are becoming more common, and the network topology is based on broadcast. So you have a broadcast station for the message broadcast, and any message relating to broadcast or any devices relating to broadcast, including your smartphone. If you use a Bluetooth, you can receive these beacon messages with your phone. Meanwhile, the mobile OS, including iOS or Android, also supports the identification of beacon. So through notification, it can push information into your phone.
So
the representative scenarios include point of interest, navigation, wayfinding, item and asset tracking. Also, the locationing, and we will enjoy more possibilities. On the right side, also the most important breakthrough for Bluetooth, which is the mesh. For Bluetooth, mesh is a milestone type upgrade. Update, so from point to point to point to multipoint and to the current multipoint architecture. Now we have mesh architecture, and this enables Bluetooth to cover wider range. And this coverage can reach more scenarios, including industrial monitoring, control, and automation. And these scenarios will enjoy more possibilities. Next, I will focus on Bluetooth mesh.
南亚技术联盟在2017年的7月份,
in July 2017, we launched Bluetooth mesh, and this is a profile, not our core specs, but the app profile. And when we launched this profile, mainly focusing on some application scenarios, and also why we launched this mesh with our membership partners. The main application scenario is that we want to scale the network topology structure. Before mesh, we have two Bluetooth devices. If these two devices are covered within the same communication range, they can connect with each other. But when it goes beyond this range, these two will be disconnected. So this disadvantage will limit the coverage of the communication. And this is why we launched Bluetooth mesh. Within the Bluetooth mesh, we also included lots of interlay
所以当一个节点向另外一个节点发生信息的时候
Send message to another node, and also these two nodes are not covered within the same wireless network. What we need to do is only to add more router interlay nodes, which will help us to transfer the messages and transmit the messages. And this can reach multi-hop and multi-path the information spread.So what characteristics do this Bluetooth mesh have? The first is among the nodes, they don't have hub or router concept. So for the Bluetooth mesh, if we pass the message to another node, as you can see here, this is a switch. So the switch needs to transmit information to the bulb.And this is the broadcast. The surrounding nodes receive information, and then to have another round of broadcasting till it reaches the destination node. And this marks the end of the information transmission. The single point of failure has limited influence for network because we can go through this kind of the path.To reach the bulb. Otherwise, we can go through this path to reach the bulb. Or alternatively, this path is also okay. So multiple paths for us to choose. When one node suffers errors, this would not have a significant impact on our network. The second influence, very important, or the second feature,This is the flooding mechanism. We use the broadcasting channel to transmit information. Also, we will authenticate the conditions. If these are qualified, then we will forward messages.By using this mechanism, the robustness of our system will be augmented. The third important feature is its security. For Bluetooth technology, this is very pretty like the wireless technology. In order to safeguard this network, we need to guarantee its security.Two very most important attack models. One is the
蓝牙设备在进行数据通信的时候，那这个窃听者使用一些抓包工具，那它可以抓到空中的数据包。那通过这个数据包，它可以进行一些信息的
Or espionage
编辑
mechanism.So it can attack or hack the information in our network. And this will invade into our network. So this is the first attack model that Bluetooth technology needs to prevent against. The second is intermediate. If we have two devices and when they have communication with each other, and Meanwhile, we have a device C. So device C can go through the intermediate mechanism. And for device A, it could tell light that this is device B, not device A, and vice versa. So this is a kind of intermediate mechanism. And we can take this means to change the information.To temper the information, and this will have significant influence on our network. So we have the advantages for the low energy Bluetooth. And now for the attacks from the intermediate, we use this OOB mechanism to prevent against the out of band. In this way, we can protect our network from being attacked. And for Bluetooth mesh, we also use AES 128 CCM, and for the encryption and
calculation.
And for the mesh, we also have the ecliptic mechanism. So we have public and private keys. And for the attacks of the spies, this works very well. Also, we also use the two layer keys. One is on the network layer, another is on the application layer. So the keys on both layers are partitioned. Also, the data are partitioned, not connected.
So,
although we use the same layer of network, we can run different data. Within the mesh, we also have device, blacklist. When we use the mesh, very important application scenario is smart home. So you can imagine this.
For example, for smart home, if you buy a bulb with Bluetooth mesh from the supermarket and you involve it into your home Bluetooth mesh network, it will have a service life up to 3, 5, 7, 8 years. But one day, ultimately, it will come to the end of its life and it may go broken and stop working, but you could not inform the user of that. They would stop working suddenly, but still, a bulb like this would contain some key message, key information of the Bluetooth mesh network at home. And if you just remove the bar and just throw it away randomly, then maybe the bulb would already include the network and application layer secret key information. And if some people get this bulb and they would access the information inside, it is possible for them to attack our home network. So Bluetooth Mesh has already considered this, and it has a black name list here.
So,
for these features, we could build up this black name list mechanism and try to upgrade and update the secret key. And for the trusted devices in the network, they could be updated with a new secret key. And this upgraded secret key will not update the secret key in the black name list. So secret key updating would help us remove the untrusted devices out of the network. And we also have publish and subscribe for Bluetooth Mesh, which is very flexible. In the network, we have different group dresses. And we also have the servers to subscribe the different group addresses, and we also have the client, and which could publish the group address information, and through publish and subscribe, our service and client could flexibly combine. And on the application layer, we could flexibly adjust the publisher and subscriber as well to make the whole application more flexible as well. And we also have a very important mechanism, the friendship one. The friendship mechanism, we talked about the low power consumption Bluetooth, but with the Bluetooth mesh, we require the node to
be up to the 100%,
receptor on time, because it is based on the flooding mechanism, and this mechanism enables, makes the Bluetooth mesh devices of a very high power consumption. And also the sensors at home, which are powered on battery, they need to be of low power. So in Bluetooth mesh, we can
here
have the front node for the bulb, and for the sensor, it is a low power node, and it requires to be powered by the battery. And in the Bluetooth mesh, the front node, when it is not sending any data, the receptor, the radio sender and receptor, the receiver could be off, which could largely reduce the work current. But because the sender and receiver is off, there might be some response problem. For example, if the node need to be communicating with the sensor and the actually the receiver and sender is off, the information might be lost. So we have a front node in the Bluetooth mesh. So for the low power node in the network, it could have a front node, which is like an agent for it in the network. And we also have some other nodes which would send data to the sensor, and the data would temporarily be stored at the front node. And then the low power node will cycle wake and the low power node would inquire the front node whether there is relevant information to the low power node, and then it could obtain the information frame by frame. So this front node is mainly to address the application of low power node. So for the Bluetooth mesh, when you want to design your product and you have some demand for low power, the Bluetooth mesh could help you. And it really works well. And then let's look at the message and state. Well, for the Bluetooth mesh, the receive and send the information through message mechanism, and in the message we would add some states, for example, on and off. These are all the states here. So in the Bluetooth mesh, we could through message and state to have some information interaction between nodes. And then let's look at some potential application use cases of Bluetooth mesh. The first is about the smart building. If we upgrade the lighting system into a Bluetooth mesh lighting system, for example, in a meeting venue like this, if we upgrade the lighting system into a Bluetooth mesh one, then naturally, we would have the Bluetooth mesh network architecture, and then the air conditioner system, the station occupancy, and some sensors, including our curtains, and all of these systems could be based on the Bluetooth mesh architecture and realize the smart control and smart monitoring for a smart building system. And another use case would be in the new retail system. Some online retailing giants are expanding to offline. So when we install the Bluetooth mesh lighting system into the supermarkets, then through the Bluetooth mesh lighting, we can have the beacons and the price labels and the sensors as well as the shopping carts, all of these could be realized through the Bluetooth mesh system. And a third use case here would be about the indoor positioning and directioning. For example, in some modern urban complexes, like in the airport and the subway stations, if we deploy the Bluetooth mesh lighting system, then beacon, indoor navigation, indoor positioning, and also the asset tracking could all be engaged into the system through Bluetooth mesh. And then let's look at the combination of Bluetooth mesh and Zephyr. Since July 2017, when Bluetooth mesh was initiated, Zephyr, as a sub-project under the foundation, since September 2017, they started to support version 1 of Bluetooth mesh, starting from 1.9.0, and since 1.10.0 in Zephyr, it already starts to support Bluetooth mesh friendship and most foundation client models. In the 1.12.0 version of Zephyr, they added persistent storage support. And this storage support enabled the application of Bluetooth mesh on Zephyr to be more commercial, and it could help storing some key message into flash or EP room. And then the Bluetooth mesh application based on Zephyr could be more sophisticated as a product. And in version 1.13.0, Zephyr added more sample codes into Bluetooth mesh. We have the lighting model, generic on-off model, these applications. And this year, in April or May, Zephyr also launched the 1.14.0, the long-term support, LTS, which helped debug the Bluetooth on Zephyr. Overall speaking, it could have very timely support to the Bluetooth mesh, Zephyr, and for the Bluetooth mesh networking, we also develop some toolkits based on Zephyr. For Bluetooth mesh networking, which is based on Zephyr, which is ported in Zephyr B. And through this version, we can build a small Bluetooth mesh network. And this sample code, you can see it's study guide has adopted provisioning. It skipped the provisioning process. And in the microbit, it is already on-premise provisioning, and it could start working directly. And the next follow-up was in May at Shenzhen on the Bluetooth convention. We had a developer session, which was also a development based on Zephyr. And that was also based on microbit with provisioning added. And on site, we used the Android and iOS to have a provisioning of the microbit. And you could click on the link to see the source code and relevant tutorials to get to get to know more about Bluetooth Mesh. And the third link is about all Bluetooth SIG resources. If as a developer you are interested, you could click on this link. If you're interested to learn more. And we also have some online ticket system so that you can contact the Bluetooth SIG. Now we have 5 minutes left. Now it's for QA and discussion time if you have any question. I have 3 questions. The first one is now you have node-node connection with Bluetooth, but with Bluetooth Mesh, is it for multi-node connection, multiple node connection? Yes, it is a multi-hopping network, but it is not necessarily for connection because it is through propagation or broadcasting. It is not on a connection mechanism. For example, if at a node it has a data and for broadcasting it could send the data to other nodes and other nodes receive it. And if it is qualified for further broadcasting, it will be sent again. It is a little bit like the UDP mechanism we have. Yes, similar. And my second question, now for the Bluetooth device, if you want to maintain connection and if you make it on the receivers, it would consume massive power, and the power consumption is related to its transmitting power. If it is the further, the more power consumption, and with the Mesh system, how would you resolve the power consumption issue? Well, it would have multiple types of nodes. As I said, the lighting model, and for the lighting system for the bulbs,
it
does not have any specific demanding for the power consumption, and the Bluetooth power consumption is neglectable for it. It is like a relay node, and we want to make sure the receiver is always on to receive the relevant information. And as I said, we also have friendship nodes. And for low power consumption sensor, for applications like this, we can adopt the low power node mechanism, and our sender and receiver would be off for a long time. And when time's up, they will be awakened to have data communication with the front nodes. And if they store temporarily the data, I would access it back and process and then send my response to the front node. So the front node is like an agent in the network. And for the Bluetooth Mesh, in the network for all the nodes, they would have different types. And based on your actual application scenario, you can have the different features set up. And the third question is about when can we realize the, when can we commercialize the Bluetooth Mesh system? Well, they have been put into the business already. We have the Bluetooth Mesh lighting sensors, switches, and the smart speakers like Xiaomi speaker and Tmall Genie. They are like the Bluetooth Mesh products. And we also have the Blue Mesh Touche products of other categories. And in the ecosystem now, we also have an app, like in Google Play and on iOS App Store, you have both the Bluetooth Mesh apps for the users. We have 1 minute left. One more question, maybe?
我可以问一下，我你跟那个 Zephyr 有什么？我没有什么研究，我想了解看一下你对
well, I would like
对
to know.
就是 Lion Mask 跟那个 Zephyr 之间的比较。
How would you compare Blue Mask Touche and Zephyr?
好，谢谢。
对，其实这个问题我们经常会遇到。
In 1 minute, maybe. Well, I come across this type of question very frequently. For ZB technology, I don't know it well, but for Bluetooth mesh, it enjoys some apparent pros. As I said, compared with smartphones, laptops, and smart loudspeakers, it could fit very well to these smart devices.All smartphones now support the low power Bluetooth technology. And the mobile systems we support now, the iOS, Virtual S, iPad OS, Android, Linux, Windows, or even some lesser known BlackBerry operation systems.These mobile systems, including Zephyr even, they all support Bluetooth technology, low-power Bluetooth. Most of them even support Bluetooth mesh. So for the developers and the member companies, including the consumers, when they choose a technology, the availability and connectivity would all be considered by them, of course.And I think Bluetooth mesh technology would enjoy some advantages in this aspect. Thank you. Now, let's come to the end of this session. Thank you for coming. Thank you.